And welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, the historical action and adventure podcast. My name is Matthew Harvey.
And my name is Stephen A. Mackay.
We're both best-selling historical fiction authors, and together we chat about all things historical and anything that could fall under the banner of action and adventure in books, film, TV and games.
And we also talk about rock music from time to time.
If you'd like to help us with our running costs and get exclusive bonus episodes every month and other cool perks, check out our Patreon page, patreon.com/rockpaperswordspodcast.
And if you enjoy the podcast, please leave us a 5-star review wherever you can online and share our posts on Facebook, X and so on to help us get the word out there. It really helps the show grow and attract more big-name guests to interview.
Right. Simon Turney, aka S.J.A. Turney, hails from Yorkshire, England, I believe. His passion for history shines through in his more than 50 novels, where meticulous research meets immersive storytelling. From ancient Rome to medieval Europe, Turney's versatile body of work brings the past to life with vivid characters and compelling narratives. In his latest novel, Caracalla, I think it's pronounced, the fourth and final novel in the Damned Emperor's series, Simon is back in Rome, this time in the 2nd century, where the rivalry between two brothers threatens to tear the empire apart. Welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, Simon Turney.
Hello, hello, hello. You make me sound so much more impressive than I actually am.
We'll be the judge of that. So, to start us off then, Simon, would you like us to tell us a bit about your new book? How did you say it was pronounced, Matthew? Caracalla? Is that right, Simon?
Problem is I write so many books at the same time that Caracalla is kind of the new book, but there's other new books sort of out and about at the same time. There's Agricola's coming out in a couple of months. Caracalla was the last one, but there's a Viking one that came out roughly the same time as Caracalla as well. So I lose track. Caracalla was the last of the Damned Emperors. The first two were produced by Orion, who then decided that they didn't want books 3 and 4. But it just so happened that my editor at Orion moved companies and turned up with Canello, who were another publisher that I was with. Therefore, he said, well, let's do the other two. So we did books 3 and 4 through Canello instead, which is great because at least I got to finish the series. The Damned Emperors, the whole idea of the Damned Emperors was to take, the Emperors of Rome, you get ones that are given apotheosis, they rise to sit among the gods and they're worshipped, added to temples and so on. And then you get odd ones who are just ignored as if they never actually ruled at all. And then you get some who are damned. They suffer damnatio memoriae, their idols are smashed, the coins are defaced, their names are chiselled off altars, and essentially they're removed from the official history of Rome. And it always happens, from what I've seen, to people who fell foul of the Senate, because the senators, of course, are the ones who make these decisions and who record history. Usually you find that these people were actually quite popular with the troops or with the ordinary people. It's just the senatorial class who damn them in the end. And it led me to thinking, really, are they the damned souls that history paints them? Which is why I still started doing this. I tackled Caligula, who clearly wasn't a nice man, but also I don't think was remotely insane. I tackled Commodus, who I think did have issues, but I think it's quite explainable as what's now called bipolar syndrome. And I tackled Domitian, who I think was somewhere on the sliding scale of OCD. And I think micromanaged everything to an extent where he annoyed a lot of people. But Caracalla was slightly different in he wasn't actually damned. This is the thing, when I was looking through the list, a lot of the damned emperors were too short-lived to be able to write a good book about because they were just, 3 months in and then knifed in the dark. A lot of them are just frankly tedious. But Caracalla leapt out, despite the fact that he wasn't damned. I think he narrowly got away with it. And he certainly wasn't popular with the Senate afterwards. There was a move to damn him, but he wasn't. But he had his brother damned. So there's a slight sort of twist in the story in the fourth and final one. I'm not going to go into it because it'll ruin it for anybody who reads it. Of course, everyone should have bought and read it by now, anyway.
Yeah,
Oh
of course.
yes, yeah. I think I got my dates muddled up when I was looking at the a bit like you with this actual podcast date. When I was looking at the thing, I don't know why I thought that the Caracalla hadn't been released yet, but I see it was released last September. So you mentioned
Yeah, the
other,
paperback's not out yet, I don't think.
and maybe I was looking at the pa it could have been the paperback version that I stumbled on and got my dates muddled up, but you mentioned that you had other books out around the same sort of time, and you're incredibly prolific, and you write in all these different timelines. So, do you want to tell us a couple of the other books that you've got coming out around now, or that have come out in the last couple of months?
I've always got like more than one iron in the fire, as it were, anyways, you know. And I just started moving, treading on your territory, treading on your toes, really, doing Dark Age stuff. Although
Yeah.
my Vikings are a bit later, really. They're around the Norman Conquest era, early 1040s, more or less. So it's more medieval, really, than Dark Age. But yeah, I write Vikings. There are a bunch of six still pagan lunatics trying to survive in a world that's becoming horribly Christian everywhere they go. So they've been down through Russia and through Byzantium and Italy and up through France, and in the one that's not out yet, but I've already written and handed to the editor. They were up in Swaledale in my area,
Right.
so I'm gradually taking them back into Scandinavia. So yeah, there's Vikings. I'm writing. It was a trilogy. Now it's a quadrilogy, if I assume that's the word.
I think it's tetralogy.
Yeah, tetralogy, that makes sense.
Aye.
I'm writing a tetralogy about the life of Gnaeus Julius Agricola, the general who conquered, well, up in your area, conquered up through north of England and Scotland. I did his non-fiction biography a few years back, and I thought, wow, what a fiction tale this would make. So I've expanded it out from the one to the other. Other than that, yeah, I think my old steady one, Praetorian, is coming back at long last. But yeah, so
How you've
mainly
written, so you've written about all of these different historical periods within the history of Rome, and also other things like Vikings that you said. And how do you decide which time periods you want to explore, and what draws you to the various historical settings for your novels?
I don't know, it's got to be something fun, hasn't it? I presume that you guys do exactly the same. When you're looking at a new series, or when it just occurs to you, like, this would make a great book, it's always because of some event, some place, some character, something hooks you. I wrote a series called the Ottoman Cycle years ago. There's four books, and it was set in sort of just post-Turkish Constantinople and around the Med at that era. And the only reason I wrote the books is because I was reading through research material on Constantinople in the Byzantine era, and just post that, just post conquest. And it turned out that there's this event that it's barely recorded. It's noted in one small source somewhere. There was a church called the Nea Ecclesia, and it was one of the biggest churches in Constantinople. And after the Turkish conquest, it was repurposed as a gunpowder storage. And it theoretically it was struck by lightning one
I was
night
going to
during a
say, it blew
violent
up, don't tell me.
storm, and yeah, it left a crater. I mean, there was not only nothing left of the Nea Ecclesia, there was nothing left of the neighborhood it was in, and they found pieces of what they think it was on the other side of the Bosphorus. So that's how big the bang was. And I thought, my God, that's a story. That needs to be a story. And it's that, or it's an interesting character, or it's a place that I've gone and thought, ooh, this needs writing about.
Just before we move on to the next question and get too far away for this, I wanted to ask, how do your publishers view it with you putting out books kind of all at the same time, pretty much? They can't be too happy about that, are they?
It gets it definitely gets complicated. There's a balancing act to a certain extent, especially since I still indie publish some stuff as well. But thus far, only very occasionally have they come close together. Usually, because I'm with the best will in the world, I'm producing one a year for a publisher. Two books if it's beginning and end of the year and there's a reasonable distance between them. So with that number, it's easy enough to shuffle releases so that they're not clashing. Right. That being said, it does occasionally clash anyway. But I mean, you can only do what you can do. With your publishers, when things go into the machine, you have very little say on dates and organization. Occasionally you might get consulted on the cover, or the editor might tell you that you can't use the word boobs in a certain paragraph. you just kind of nod and smile and go, well, okay, I'll try and promote that around the 15th of March or whatever. Yeah. Don't you? So, and I'm not very good at promoting anyway. I'd rather just sit there hammering away at the keyboard.
I think that's probably the best way to promote your stuff is just to write another book anyway. But before we move on again, is that a true story? Did you get told not to write boobs?
No, but I'm waiting for something similar. In the fifth Viking book, I told a joke, and I'll tell you in a minute, just so that you can edit it out, because you won't want this in the podcast, I'm sure.
But
I told a joke,
content.
And I thought when my editor reads that, he's going to say, you can't put a book. And I'm just waiting for that to come back. There's just a moment where there's a big, big sort of berserker Viking called Bjorn, and the leader of the guy called Halfdan. And Halfdan and Bjorn are riding along, and he's given to sort of flights of fancy and tall tales and things. And he turns to Halfdan and he says, sir, did I ever tell you about the time I f***ed a woman with three breasts? And Halfdan turns back to him and goes, most men would use their dick. And I'm waiting for that to come back to me and, well, bite me in the ass.
Oh, that should be all right.
Yeah, we got the quote for the podcast there. That's the
Simon Dudley
Alan
says,
Davies has yet untitled. This is
that will be the advert on the little thing. We can do a Facebook ad with that, just repeating.
And your picture beside it, yep.
Yeah.
People will be expecting that of me anyway. Fights and fart gags. I've always said, my writing is fights and fart gags.
And drinking as well. What other periods would you like to write about then? We've seen guys like David Gilman, Douglas Jackson and Simon Scarrow moving from ancient or medieval periods to the Second World War recently. Do you fancy anything like that?
There's always things I want to write about. I wanted to write the Second World War one. My sister-in-law is Polish from Krakow area, and I've been over there a couple of times, been around Auschwitz a couple of times, which is a sobering experience at the best of times, and I really wanted to tell a story about it, but I didn't want it to be like anything that's been done before, and I spent the best part of a year penning this idea, pulling all this stuff together, all this information, what I thought was a really good plot, a really deep, thoughtful, emotional plot, with as much historical details I don't put in, but to be honest, I mean, my great knowledge is Roman, or sort of post-Roman, sort of early medieval at best. Second World War is just stuff that I've been and watched tanks move around. That's about where it goes. And I put together this plan, and I sent it to a guy called Rob Schaefer, who's a German war historian that I know. And I said, what do you think? When it came back, it had more red pen on it than anything I have seen in my entire life. I mean, there was more red pen than there was my original ink. And I thought, okay, no, just back away. Never touch that with a barge pole.
But in what regard? Was it like lack of, like you'd made mistakes?
It was, this unit couldn't be there. This soldier wouldn't do this. This, it's everything historical I had got wrong. Because it's not my era by any stretch of the imagination. I love the idea of writing in it, but I clearly have proved that I absolutely have no talent whatsoever in that area. So I'm leaving that one well alone. There are plenty of people who can do it better than me.
But as a matter of interest, do you send your historical novels, like Viking ones or Roman ones, to experts in those time periods, because you might find the same thing happens.
Yeah. I do bounce Roman ideas off certain people. The Viking one was largely plucked from the air, it has to be said, originally. But it was well researched, but everything in it I had to sort of drag from books. I've read probably every bloody Viking research text there is now, I should think. But the Roman stuff, I mean, I tend, because I've been doing it, I've been writing for 2 decades in Roman stuff and researching it for four. So I'm quite conversant with Rome. So on the whole, I can write Roman stuff, and then when I get confused or I'm uncertain about something, I'll find someone and bounce the idea off them. And there are people around who are immensely clever. There are people in Roman archaeology and history who, I am a tugboat and they are the Titanic. Not the Titanic, that's terrible. I'm a tugboat and they are the Queen Mary. I don't know, something huge and
QE2,
impressive.
something huge that's not going to sink. Yeah.
I think I'm digging myself a big hole here, but anyway, yeah, I'll bounce the ideas off the Mike Bishop, an archaeologist on Hadrian's Wall, and all sorts of who's the person? Simon Elliott. I've been recently sort of bouncing ideas off as well, because they know their stuff, and if I can't come up with the solution, usually if they can't, they can point me in the right direction. But I like to get as much detail right as I can, and occasionally I've cocked it up. In the first Praetorian book, in the first edition, the first release, quickly replaced Rufinus is hit with a tomato. That became a pomegranate really, really, really quickly. The first time I got a message. In one of Marius's Mules books, Caesar goes back to Rome, which he theoretically couldn't do while he was a governor of Gaul. He would have to give up his imperium as governor of Gaul to get into Rome. But I went back after I realized that later on. I went back and fudged away that he could have done it. There's always a solution to these things, but the worst bit of research I ever did was I was describing in Praetorian, I was describing Rufinus riding into Rome from the west, and I wanted to, he was passing along the line of the Aqua Traiana aqueduct, which comes down the Janiculum Hill and across the Tiber via some mills. And I thought, I want to get it right. I like to get these things right. I can't go there. This was during COVID. I had no chance of getting to Rome to actually walk it. So here we go, Google Street View. It's Google Street Viewed. I Google Street Viewed about 9 miles of road into Rome, just to see where the aqueduct's visible above ground, where it dips, where it rises, what it looks like. And it took, a whole day of research just following this aqueduct meter by meter into Rome. And when I looked at it afterwards, I thought, you bloody idiot. It appears in one line in the book. It's at best half a paragraph, and I've spent an entire day following the line of it just so I can go, oh yeah, occasionally dipped and rose.
Yeah.
There you
That's dedication.
It's funny you said about the amount of red pen on that World War II one you did. Reminds me of the I've done one short story for the Black Library for Warhammer 40,000,
I remember
and
seeing some of your comments on this in a group chat.
the Ah, yes. Well, the amount of edits that I got back was just ridiculous. It was more tedious than a historical novel. And this is a 10,000 word, short story, as opposed to 140,000 word novel. And I had more comments back. It took longer to go through the process because it would be things like, that guy couldn't use this gun at that regiment as this thing here, and
That's me in the Second World War.
just, oh, okay.
It's the same reason I don't do samurai. I'd love to do samurai, but I'll get it all horribly, horribly wrong.
So many of your novels involve characters facing moral dilemmas and complex choices about life in general and all sorts of things. How do you approach crafting characters that resonate with modern readers, but also navigating the intricate challenges of their sort of historical contexts and marrying those two things together and making it exciting and relevant to modern people, but also be somehow realistic to the times that you're writing about.
That's a balancing act, that one, isn't it? You've got to make them likable to the reader. They've got to be sympathetic to some extent. Otherwise, the reader's going to put the book down. There are exceptions to this. Mark Lawrence, fantasy writer, you were Mark
yeah.
Lawrence?
Yeah.
Prince of Thorns by Mark Lawrence, in which his principal character is horrible. I mean, he's a sociopath. He's just wicked, nasty. He's a nasty, nasty human being. And yet somehow you just can't go, oh, go on, get him, you know? And that's a talent. That's a real talent to write someone who's nasty and get them rooted for. I tried to do it, again, back to Caracalla. I tried to do this with Caracalla, because Caracalla was clearly not a nice man. He was an angry man and a violent man with a bad temper. You look at his, all the other Roman emperors look serene and imperial, and Caracalla just looks, in every photo, he looks like he's just drank 15 Stellas and kicked his wife to death. In every statue, he just looks mean, angry, glaring, horrible. And I think, obviously, you know, history tells us that's what he was like. And yes, with some of the emperors, you might want to argue that. But I mean, his statues were built while he was alive, surely. You know, if he wasn't like that, he would have said, stop doing that with my statues. So, I mean, he must have been like that. He must have been an angry, violent, horrible man, really. Not necessarily insane or stupid. He was quite, I think he was quite clever. He was a good military leader. He and his brother hated each other from the outset. And essentially the book is about him and his brother. And I wanted to write as close to the truth as you could divine between these two brothers. I wanted to write Caracalla as he's described in sources as when a child, as being actually quite respectful and pleasant as a child to his parents. And I wanted to write him just being this respectful Roman child who gradually slides into a sort of a really violent, horrible anger stoked by his brother throughout the whole thing. And the two of them virtually at war with each other. I wrote this and I sent it to my editor, and he sent it back and said, I think you need to make Caracalla more likable. I said, but he's not likable. He's a horrible, horrible man. And he said, well, you know, you're going to lose readers. The readers you've got to get behind the character. Yeah. I said, well, all right, how's about I make his brother worse? And then he'll, you know, by comparison, he'll look better, because his brother's going to be even more horrible. So I turned, you know, Getter into the most horrible, wet, toady, nasty little creature. But in the end, I still made Caracalla nicer than I wanted to. I removed all sorts of scenes of him being utterly horrible to people. But you do what you have to do to get the book in front of people and read. Mm-hmm. But I would like to be able to write more. This sounds awful, to write more truth than I can. But I think people are only willing to read a certain amount of stuff.
Yeah. Exactly. You don't want too many anti-heroes. I read one by Ian Graham years ago, a fantasy book called Monument. And the guy in that is just a complete bastard. But it's such a brilliant book. I absolutely loved it. It's really stuck in my memory. It's been one of the best books I've ever read, because in the end he does something good, but the whole way through the book he's horrible. And it was a real kind of shock to my system to read a book and think, how the hell did he do that? How did he write that so well? And it kind of was a failure, the book, really, in terms of sales. Because as you say, your editor said, people won't want to read it, but I just thought it was a fantastic book. The guy was so clever how he managed to write it like that.
Yeah. Woulda, coulda, shoulda.
Speaking of anti-heroes, you collaborated with Gordon Doherty on the Rise of Emperors books.
Gordon Doherty, anti-hero at your service.
that was just the next question, so I thought I'd segue into it nicely. So how did that collaboration come about, and how did you navigate the process of writing it together? We're planning on doing a non-fiction book, me and Matthew. And it's been that, a bit of a pain figuring.
That's a podcast in itself. You know?
Well, exactly. That's why I thought I'd mention it. But we're more worried about how to share the royalties. But, so how does it work with you?
Well, it came about because there was a reenactment and history show called History Live down at in Northamptonshire, back in 2012, 2013, I think it was, something like that, we used to go. And we went 2 or 3 years in a row, several of us, and we met up with a whole bunch of other writers and history nuts. And it was I think it was the first time I'd actually met Gordon face to face, though we'd known each other online for years. And the year that this happened, History Live was rained off. It was the year that the whole site was flooded, and it was a disaster. And they just cancelled the whole weekend. But of course, everybody booked their hotels and transport and everything. So we just ended up in the pub for an entire day. You know, about 15 historical writers and readers just all sat just gently getting trolleyed in the middle of nowhere, which is a great place for bouncing ideas. When you're trapped like that, it's brilliant. And Gordon and I, we just sort of bounced this idea of how would it be if you wrote a, how could you write a story, two of you write one story between you? And we just came up with the idea, you know, 6 months down the line, we just sort of bounced the idea again and went, you know, we could actually do that. And then it sort of started to progress, started to snowball. The idea came about that we could do it, tell the story from the two alternate views, chapter by chapter. So essentially what you've got is one long story, but you have to keep alternating the viewpoint each chapter. And then, I mean, it was 2 years just planning the plot line so that it worked between the two characters, I think, which involved meeting up every few months, bringing the families and meeting up in a holiday cottage somewhere for 3 days, drinking more whiskey than a human should really, really contemplate in one weekend. Going out and seeing Roman sites, because yeah, everywhere we go, you have to book somewhere near a Roman site.
Yeah.
Again, drink Roman sites and then just sitting hammering away at keyboards while you know the families sort of bumble around and try and pretend that you're remotely normal. so yeah, we hammered it together, and then the idea was sound. We didn't know whether it would work in practice. So we started writing, and the idea was, you know, I would write a chapter and then I would send it to Gordon. He would look at it, read it through, edit it, give his notes to me on what he thought about it. And then once we'd approved that, he would write the next chapter and then send that to me. I would look at the two chapters together and edit his, come up with what looked best, and then pass it back to him, and he'd write the next chapter. Well, I'd write the next chapter, and so on and so forth, so that you're always editing the previous chapter, passing it through to the next person. And it worked like a dream. I'm not sure how it would work for anyone else, because Gordon and I are both a little bit OCD. Gordon possibly worse than me. He wouldn't appear to be, to anybody who met him. He seems to be a relaxed and you know, perfectly calm and fun guy. And then I look at his Dropbox folders where we do everything, and mine's, you know, it's got one sheet of characters, and it says things like, you know, he stumbles a bit, occasionally he blows his nose too much or whatever. And Gordon's has got like eye color and height and, you know, childhood histories for every character. Like, you know, he only walks on and just says my lord once in the whole book, and you've got his eye color. But yeah, I suppose it works different for everybody, different ways people do these things. For Gordon and me, it worked like a dream, and it was good fun. I'm not sure whether it would be the same doing it for non-fiction. That would be interesting. Yeah. I think I'm too precious over the non-fiction stuff. I wouldn't let anyone touch it.
Aye. Well, the stuff that we've already written, actually, we're just going to kind of pull it together and put it out as a rock, paper, swords thing.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll see if it's any use to anybody.
See if we can make some money.
That's
it's all about the making money at the end.
Exactly, that's the goal.
So you've written As we said, you've written about emperors, you've written about Vikings and foot soldiers and famous characters and less famous characters. So do you prefer writing about famous figures or lesser known or overlooked historical figures or unknown historical figures? How do you feel about the different types of characters?
I like the unknowns or the underdogs. I like the underdogs, always the underdogs. When Gordon and I wrote Constantine and Maxentius, I from square one, I'm going, look, I'm doing Maxentius. I need Maxentius. He's going to be my kind of what's the word? I'm going to resurrect his reputation because he is, he's one of the, again, he's one of the sort of damned emperors, as it were. All his busts were re-chiseled to look like Constantine. Is you know his it, all the Basilica of Maxentius in Rome is also the Basilica of Constantine because one built it, but the other put the name on it. And all these things happen. I like the underdog. I like the underdog characters. Saying that, I've written Caesar. He's hardly an underdog, but I like. I like interesting characters. I like small characters. I mean, the Ottoman series, my character was a Greek-speaking thief from the back streets of Constantinople, Turkish Constantinople. And I think the difference is, if you're a famous character, you are so bound by historical record. I mean, you can reinterpret it, but you have to stick to it one way or another. If you write, if you write Caesar, you have to read Arrian, Plutarch, Caesar's own diaries. You have to Cato. Anybody who's spoken to him, written about him, and you have to agree with your story has to agree with those, even if it twists them. With a character that's unknown, you could play. I mean, you still have to have the events there and the places there. But the interaction is totally different, and I like that. I like it's a move, I suppose, towards more fantastic. It's more fantasy in a way, because you can be inventive. You can play with it. You don't have to go, well, it's 15 miles from here to here, and he was here then, and he was there then, so he can't have in the middle gone off and rogered some big bosomed buxom bar wench and caught the clap. So. Which, that's the sort of story we want to write.
Where are we? You were one of the indie authors who inspired me to give it a go, where I read your first Marius Mules novel and I saw how well it was doing. So, having experienced success with both traditional publishing and self-publishing, what are the pros and cons of both approaches for you?
I thought you were more contemporaneous with me, but
No, no, I don't think. No, you'd been out 2013. My first book came out.
I suppose, yeah, only for a few years though. It was only a few years.
Yeah, but that it was you and Gordon had
Yeah.
maybe a couple of books out, and I saw that yous were doing really well. So it was like, because I'd been looking for a publisher, and then I realised, well, you don't have a publisher, and you're doing so well. So that was why I started self-publishing in the first place.
I wrote mine as a the first Marius's Mules. I wrote it as a test to myself to see whether I could write it, whether it could be done, whether you could turn Caesar's diaries into something remotely readable to a modern reader. Pardon me, it's fiction. So I wasn't intending. I was never expecting to make any real money out of it, and it was released under, there was a company called You Write On at the time,
Yeah, I remember that.
and they were Arts Council funded to print a certain number of books, and yes, you had to contribute, which I suppose is the start of the vanity press thing. But yeah, I got mine through You Write On, and certain paperbacks came out. People read them, not many people, admittedly. I remember looking at the website going, oh, three people bought this. Oh, awesome. Three people have read my book. And, it got really good reviews from the people who read it, like nine reviews because like nine people read it. And I was talking to a friend of mine, Robin, and he said, why is it not on Kindle? And I said, what's Kindle? And this is 2010, 2011, something like that, I think. He said, if it's not on Kindle, it's not going to sell like you want it to sell. And he pushed me to release it as an ebook, and I put it on Kindle, and it suddenly exploded. I was lucky because I hit the very start of the boom in ebooks. And I think we were still riding high on the coattails of Rome and Gladiator and stuff like that. So Rome was still a big thing in historical fiction. It just, everything worked at the time just to my advantage, which is good because I'm fundamentally lazy and stupid. So if everything hadn't, if the stars hadn't aligned, I'd be sitting in a cardboard box somewhere going, I could have been someone. Yeah, it just kind of worked for me, and I think it's become a lot harder since then. You will have been all right because you will have hit the same time, and yep. Matt, because yours were indie published originally.
Yeah, right? he was just a year after me.
You will have hit the same time when that big boom was going on. The bubble was expanding, and everyone was buying, and you know, before, dare I say it, COVID, Brexit, everything else that's just made, you know, people have become broke and not buying books anymore. But yeah, it worked for me. I sold enough books that I built up a following that then I was fairly sure that when I released, you know, new books, people were going to buy them because I already had a set amount of readers, which was nice. I think people who are getting into it now are struggling tremendously because and still the traditionally published books as well, but the market is just glutted left, right and center, and actually making your way, just carving a path, is becoming harder and harder and harder, I think. And I think it is even for the traditionally published now as well. The amount of traditionally published authors I know who've sort of had to back away and said, well, you know, they won't accept any more novels from me, it's just not selling enough, it's not selling like it was. I think it's just because there's so much in the market now. That being said, I still think for indie publishing, if you do it right, if it's properly edited and it's a good quality, the profit margins in indie publishing are higher. So long as you are willing to put the work in, and so long as you've got the right product, I think you can actually make more as an indie writer. I think the reason I went, I sought a traditional contract as well is purely selfish. It's that I would love to see my book in an airport. I would love to see my book in Waterstones. You know, I would love to see my book on the Times bestseller list. Ha ha ha! As if I was seeing my book on the Times bestseller list. But it's that. It's. I suppose it's just pride, you know, hubris. I think there are some publishers are better than others. I'm going to use no names here because I'm not going to alienate anyone, because you know the future is what the future is. But some publishers I have worked with put the absolute minimum effort into anything they've done, and the result has been clear. You know, the books they've come out, they've been, everyone's like, oh, what a good book, and then it's, you know, no sales vanished. Yeah. Well, that's because you didn't do anything mm-hmm. with it, you just yeah. left it to bomb. Other publishers, and you know, Matt will probably back me up on this, the one that we share, at least talking to them, they're interested in the books, they're interested in the history, they have enthusiasm, they want to know more, and they want to help, and they want to take part, and I like that. The publisher, you know, both my current publishers are like that. They both really like the stories, they want to get more involved, they want to get more stories out there, and that's nice. It's nice to have that around you, which you don't get as an indie. It's nice to have the support of people who are, you know, encouraging you, and sometimes it's quite nice to have them giving you targets as well, because without that I'd probably just flounder around in the swamp of despair when I hit writer's block. like I have done the last couple of days. But yeah, there are advantages and disadvantages to both. I don't think any form of publishing is better than any other form of publishing, with the exception of vanity press, where you are essentially paying somebody to produce something that you could really do yourself a damn sight cheaper and probably better.
Yeah. So are you happy with where you are at the moment, being what would be called a hybrid author then, having, you know, some indie books coming out, some traditionally published?
I did for a while. I did think about just going fully mainstream, which I could do now. I mean, could sort of drop the indie side altogether. But I like the indie side as well. I still like that. I'm enjoying writing the Praetorian books still as an indie series. And I sort of talked to my agent actually earlier today and mooted the idea of other indie projects as well. I'm not going to leave it behind. And from a horribly mercenary point of view, it's a really sort of uncertain world out there at the moment in every way, shape and form. And if you can have, you know, 15 different baskets of eggs, only one of them is going to get broken at a time. It's the way to do it. I think having a finger in every pie is great. The only downside is that sometimes those pies sort of look at each other askance across a room and go, why are you playing with that pie? Why are you eating that pie as well? I try and play nice because I like both my publishers and I like indie publishing as well. And I want to be enthusiastic about it all. And I want them to be enthusiastic about it all. And you'll know from talking to people in the publishing world, half the time these people move around every couple of years anyway and end up working for a different publisher. So, you know, they might currently be saying, you know, why are you working with him? And then suddenly 2 years down the line is working with him. So, I don't know. Balance it. A seal with a ball on his nose.
Yeah, I agree with you.
So I'm going to ask you about something a bit out of left field. But I noticed when I was researching you, I think, Simon, that you are a graduate of the Open University.
I am.
And Stephen and I both are as well. So all three of us are graduates of the Open University. And I just wondered, how do you think, and for anyone listening that doesn't know the Open University, it's a distance learning university in Britain. So, and usually for mature students, not limited to that, but anyway, it's all done via remotely. So you don't go and have to
Very prestigious.
Yeah, very prestigious in the UK. Yeah. So anyway, how do you think your degree, doing your degree in later life, has helped with your writing?
There's a story, because there's always a story, isn't there? I didn't plan on doing Open University. I when I left school, I thought, I want to be a lawyer. And I went and did a law A level and discovered that it's really, 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 really hard. So I gave that one up. And then I thought, you know, I mean, history would always be my love anyway, but I was looking career-wise, because no one makes a living out of history, do they? So I thought, oh, computers. I enjoy computers. Of course, this is back in the day of ZX Spectrums and Acorn Electrons and things. I enjoy computers. I'll go and do computers. So I went to Teesside Poly for a year. It was supposed to be a two-year course, an HND in computer science. And I discovered that 90% of the course seemed to be mathematics and statistics. And I have about as much mathematical ability as a sponge. So I walked away from that one after a year feeling very humiliated. Took a year out, worked for British Gas and all sorts of random people. And then went down to the University of Keele in Stoke-on-Trent and studied classics and history. And all would have been fantastic, despite the fact that clearly I hardly ever went to a lecture or a tutorial. I spent most of my time drinking in the students' union bars or asleep. but still, I failed the first year, but I went back and I got it and I went on to do a second year. And then I made this, I was sat at a party in my room, as you had, and we'd all had far too much to drink, and pizza arrived, and I decided to cut the pizza, No pizza cutter. I was a student, so I picked out my scout knife to cut the pizza with because that's, it was to hand. And while cutting the pizza with a scout knife, I proceeded to almost entirely sever the tendon between my thumb and my forefinger on the blade of the scout knife. And I didn't even notice. I was so happily merry. I didn't even notice I'd done it until I
Merry.
threw my arm out and gestured wildly at someone, and blood apparently went slosh up the wall. And they went, "Oh, I think you may need an ambulance." So there we are, straight in the ambulance off to North Staffordshire Infirmary, and lots of stitches. No anaesthesia because they said it would be dangerous because I was already far too anaesthetized already. And this was just before the exams, so I thought, oh well, I can't write, and it wasn't the day of keyboards and PCs, so what am I going to do? So I talked to the university, and they said, well, we can put you off. You can come back and resit. Problem was, because it's a tendon in your writing hand, it takes a hell of a long time to properly heal. And the time of the resits, there was no hope of me getting back and doing them. So essentially, I left Kiel under a cloud, unfinished, because I couldn't really write properly at the time. So I went off and did all sorts of random jobs. I worked in the car industry. I worked in the paint industry. Did all sorts of some peculiar things for a while. And then while I was working in IT for an insurance company, I started riding Marius's mules because you have to keep yourself looking busy, and if you're doing nothing, they get you to mop a floor. So I wrote because it looked like you were working then. I got back into history while I was doing it. I thought, well, I need to finish my degree. I need to finish my course. So I thought, well, I'm working, I'm writing, why not? So I applied to Open University, took the credits that I'd already got, because you can get a certain amount of credits for the university degrees you've done. So I got a certain, I essentially I cut out a year and a half or something like that from OU for what I'd done at Keele, and then finished it at OU. And I've been meaning to go back and do a master's for God knows how long, but the problem is, who has time when you're
Yeah, I'm the
writing
same.
books and you have a family?
Yeah, this is
But
true.
yeah,
Yeah,
I
I'm the
finished
same.
in OU. I
Well, that's
tried
good.
everywhere else first.
Remember years ago, just on your slicing your hand open with a knife in your trunk, I had a friend. We were all drinking, and for some reason, we were trying to open a free Bentos pie. And if you remember how they always used to work, you would get bits of it open, and we'd got half of it open. And he tried to open the rest with his fingers. And I can distinctly remember him putting his hand over it, and I was staring at him thinking, Jesus, he's not going to do that, is he? And he did. And it was the exact same ambulance called, and I think he tore all the tendons in his entire hand.
Oh, ouch, ouch,
But
ouch, ouch. Yeah.
such a crazy story. It sounds unbelievable, but Yeah, so I think there's a lesson there for anyone listening. don't drink. Don't drink, or at least don't drink enough that you cut your hands off when you're trying to cut your finger.
And
Yeah,
but it does
brilliant.
make you creative.
Yeah. That's true.
According to the New Scientist magazine, anyway, that's an interview I still live by. Apparently, if you're in the arts side, alcohol is a bonus.
I can believe that. Just
Okay, I
avoid
can.
free Bentos pies.
Yeah.
So it's been great talking to you. At the end of every podcast episode, of course, we always ask the same questions, and we are there. So the first questions I ask, and it's what have you been reading and what have you been watching recently, Simon?
That's going to be really, really, really dull. I have been reading Tacitus. I have been reading Cassius Dio. I have been reading Plutarch. It's been almost entirely Roman source material, with one exception. Go on, I'll plug it for him. I have been reading Sword of the War God by Tim Hodgkinson. It's coming out soon, in April, through Zeus. I've been reading the ARC of that.
Is it good? Because I think we're getting them on to talk
I'm
about
enjoying
it.
it. Yeah, it's Not what I would have written, because it's more, it moves a lot more into the divine and the magical sort of side of stuff.
Right.
And it's bringing an oddly Viking sort of aspect to the Huns and Romans, which I was not expecting. But it's fresh, it's interesting, it's different, and it's certainly a lot different to reading Plutarch, Tacitus, Arrian, Cassius Dio, anyone like that. So yeah, they're what I've been reading. What I've been watching. Slow Horses, because Gary Oldman is the biz. Ted Lasso, because everyone needs something to laugh at the end of the day. Foundation. You'll notice all these are on
Yes, yeah. You're
Apple
making
TV.
you're
The
getting your
reason is
money's worth.
exactly because I took out the free
The free
month
subscription.
stuff. I binge watch everything on Apple, then get rid of it.
Well, is Foundation any good? Because I absolutely love those books, but I'm terrified that they'll just ruin them like production
I've
companies
enjoyed
usually
it.
do. Yeah.
I haven't read the books for about 30 years, so I
Right.
can't remember how close they are to the books, but there's certainly a lot of the element in there. And they're really good fun to watch. Pardon me, took a little getting into, but then any sci-fi worth its salt does. I mean, The Expanse took me about three episodes before I had the faintest idea what was going on. And it remains probably my favorite series of all time. But yeah, so Ted Lasso, Slow Horses, and Foundation. And I just started watching the movie Rebel Moon. Because at the end of the
Okay.
day, when you've spent your time with Plutarch, what you want is to watch people fire lasers and things blow
Fair enough.
Words to live by. Here we go for the last question then, Simon.
Go for
And I know you listen to music when you're writing. I'm sure you've told me before, so because you are a fan of a lot of the bands that I love.
Absolutely.
What have you been listening to recently, and what do you listen to when working on your novels?
I vary what I'm listening to depending on the tone or pace of what I'm writing. I write a lot of battle scenes. When I write a lot of battle scenes, I listen to a lot of Scandinavian death metal.
Yeah.
I listen to Insomnium, In Flames, Arch Enemy, things like that when I'm writing battle scenes, because it fuels the furious side of things. It's no use if you're writing a romantic scene having Insomnium playing in the background, because it's not going to work. And equally, I would avoid AC/DC for similar reasons. Pink Floyd, I listen to a lot while I'm writing. For the quieter moments, I love a bit of Floyd. Early Dire Straits, when there was still a sort of bluesy band. I like all sorts of different music as well. But what I've been listening to recently is a band, particularly a band called Soen, Soen, who are Scandinavian again, but they're I suppose somewhere sort of in the middle. They're not the sort of thing that we listen to that our wives plug their ears when when it's on the TV, but still sort of fairly hefty. I'm gearing up for a season of gigs. So I'm starting listening to all the stuff that we're going to see. I'm going to see In Flames and Arch Enemy. I'm going to go and see Aelstorm and Korpiklaani. And I'm going to see The Levellers as well. So I've got to gear up all that music over the next few months so I can remember all the tracks when I'm bouncing around like a lunatic.
Brilliant. So, before we go then, for the what's next? What's your next book coming out? Want to plug?
Next one coming out is Agricola Invader, the first of the Agricola tetralogy or whatever it was. In which it's the story of Agricola's first time in Britain when he's a tribune with the Second Legion, still a young, a late teenager. But although he's a Roman officer serving in the Legion, it just so happens that he happens to hit one of the most important times in Roman British history, because he serves over here during the invasion of Anglesey and the suppression of the Druids, and the year that Boudicca revolted and the Battle of Watling Street. So there's an
Wow.
awful lot to get your teeth into in that one season. So that's the
Brilliant.
next one. That's out in March. So
Excellent.
Okay,
That'll be
well,
exciting then.
yeah. So, well, brilliant. Best of luck for
Yeah,
that and all the other
good
millions of
luck.
books that you've already got out and that you've got coming out. And it's been a
You. We
great
should
pleasure having you
get
on.
together. We should do one, the three of us, a dark age book.
Wow. Yeah, we could. We know enough Dark Age authors now. We could do one of those ones like they did before
Chapter
with
each.
the do a chapter each or a short story each all
Oh,
around
like
a
A Day of
certain.
Fire. I Simon's done a
Yeah.
few like that.
We could do
Aye. Yeah,
something like
I did
that.
a couple of those with the American
Yeah.
authors.
Yeah.
Yeah. The hell with those is the editing, trying to tie everything together.
I
Right.
imagine, yeah. I would imagine that and also somebody actually organizing it all.
Yeah, fortunately, I was
Because
never involved.
yeah, it's the herding the cats thing that would put me off. I mean, I wouldn't mind writing the short story for something like that, but not going to
I was
organize it.
almost signed up to run one of those, and it kind of died, and I never managed to do it, which for which I'm immensely grateful. I don't think I would ever have managed. I would just be tearing my hair out.
I can imagine. Well,
Needs people
thanks.
more organized than me.
Thanks, Simon.
Brilliant.
It's
Thanks
been
very much,
great.
Simon. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Glad you could come along.
That's it for today's episode. We hope you've enjoyed it. Don't forget to leave a review and subscribe. And a special thanks to our, at the moment, only Patreon producer, Luke Gauchy. Don't forget, you can sign up to Patreon and become a producer too.
Let us know if you have any questions or things you'd like us to cover in future episodes. We're on facebook.com/rockpaperswordspodcast and x at rock_swords. You can find out more about our books at matthewharfrey.com and stephenamackay.com.
The theme music is written and performed and copyrighted by us. Until next time, a Rock Paper Swords, it's goodbye from me, Matthew Harvey.
And it's goodbye from me, Stephen A. Mackay.
And remember, whatever adventure and action you have going on in your life, be kind.
I get the line wrong again, didn't I? Stay safe.
Ah, I did. And happy reading.